Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here. What I would like to do is sort of give a little bit of a view. I'd like to talk about four quick subjects, and then we'll open it up for questions. The four topics I want to talk about is, and I keep hearing it all the time, and I read it all the time, is why is Maine not prosperous? Well, it's very simple. It is a very simple formula, and I did not invent it. I just look at all the states around the country, and you look at the 10 top states, and you look at what they have in common to make them very prosperous. Give you an example. I'll give you two of them because they're in the warm weather. Texas and Florida. What do they have in common? Texas is arguably the number one state in America. Florida seems to think that they're a close second or maybe even first at time. They go back and forth. The thing they both have in common, no income tax. It's very simple, no income tax. You get rid of the income tax, it's the largest wage increase you're ever going to see in the state of Maine. It's about $900 million. And I will argue, and I've been in the private sector 45 years and been governor now 5.5 years, and I will argue that you spend your money much better than the government does. So I think taxes is the number one issue that I will say is a problem. Along with taxes is the death tax, right closely behind it, because many people, when they turn 65, they'll go to Florida, they go to South Carolina, North Carolina, Georgia. I can go on and on and on because it's somebody from all over the country. They go to Arizona. I know many, many people who are Mainers who live in New Hampshire because they like to be close. But they're there because we have a death tax, one of 19 states, and we also are a very highly taxed state. Until we learn that you can't tax yourself into prosperity, we're going to have difficulty. Secondly, energy costs. You know, every day I hear newspaper articles will say, well, we're the lowest in New England, we're competitive in New England. That's true, we are competitive in New England. The difference with New England and Maine is we are 90% of our state is a forest. And forested states are not New England states for the most part. We compete against North Carolina, Georgia, Wisconsin, Minnesota, and every single one of them, energy costs are a minimum of 30% lower than Maine. It's just lower than we are. Wisconsin, we just lost a company. Didn't lose a company. We were working with a company from Taiwan to come to Maine and buy the paper mill in Old Town. So they were pretty smart people. They came in, they hired a consultant. They said, look at the entire country to see how Maine fares with the rest of the country. They came back and said that we were the 19th highest place to do business in America, and they were going to go to Wisconsin because they were cheaper to do business, and they are very big in pulp and paper. In fact, they're number one and we're number two. So they thought that was a better fit for their capital. So those are really big issues that everyone makes light of. Everybody wants to make light of the fact that our energy costs are not high. We're competitive in New England. But New England, we depend, and our economy has been built on forestry, fishing, and farming. And we need to have, if we're going to be successful in the forest industry, we need to have low energy costs because pulp and paper and sawmills are very, very dependent on energy. So that's one big thing. People say, well, why didn't you support the solar energy bill that was in the legislature? Very simple. We currently pay 14 cents for our electricity. With the solar contract that they sold, which was an above market contract, market right now, assuming 14 cents is market, but it's considerably below that. If it's 14 cents, it was above 14 cents. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out it's more expensive than where we are now. That contract was 22 cents. So your electricity bill would have gone up a third, roughly. That's what we're talking about. My mission is to lower your cost, lower the cost of doing business in Maine. And those are two big issues, two major, major issues. The other two issues I want to talk to you about is the minimum wage that is currently being proposed at $12. It sounds good on the surface. It really does. The problem with it is Maine, with its economy, its number one industry is tourism. Number two industry is pulp and paper. Number one industry is very, very dependent on people coming to Maine. It's very, very dependent on customer service. It's very, very dependent on restaurants and hotels. The problem with this bill is it takes away the tip credit. That says that if you're a waiter and a waitress, you're going to get paid minimum wage, the new minimum wage, let's say $10 or $11 an hour, $12 an hour. And many people who work in restaurants in the summer make $27, $28, $30 an hour. That's the big problem. So don't expect great service in restaurants. Number two, young people are not going to find jobs. Young people and those who are just starting out. We have a habit here calling it minimum wage, and we should have a high minimum wage. A minimum wage is intended to be a starter wage. That's where you start out working. It's not intended to be a lifetime wage. It never was. There are 6,000 people, roughly, that work full-time on minimum wage in the state of Maine. So it's clearly a starter wage. The problem is the configuration of Maine businesses. There's about 45,000 businesses in Maine, of which about 200 are large employers. I'd say like a Walmart, a Hannaford, Bath Ironworks, those are big employers, about a couple hundred companies that do that. The rest of the companies are less than 100 people or less than 50 people for the most part. Those people, those companies are highly owned, primarily all owned by families. You've heard of the Ma and Pa store. You've heard about the little hardware store. Those are all local owned companies. And what they do is they hire local people. And when the owners are threatened with higher labor costs, they work harder and they lay off people. That's the problem. Now, California and Washington State issued $15 an hour minimum wages. I just read a report from Governor Brown, and Governor Brown's a Democrat, and I don't often see or agree with things he says, but he said this is absolutely correct. The minimum wage of $15 is destroying their economy. They're going to have a $4 billion deficit in revenue because so many people are being laid off. Well, we can try to close the doors. So basically, what we're finding is the same thing is going to happen here. So I've talked about the tourist industry. I've talked about the youth. Let me tell you where the big boogeyman is. The biggest problems are elderly. If minimum wage right now is $7.50 or $7.65, whatever the rate is, I'm not even sure, because quite frankly, I don't know of anybody that personally that's working at minimum wage. Even at Martin's, starting wage is way above minimum wage. Walmart, starting salary is above minimum wage. So the problem is with this minimum wage, it's got an effect. Everybody that's working, let's say you're $5 above minimum wage today and minimum wage goes up to $12, you're going to want to be $5 above minimum wage. You're not going to want to lose where you are. Got a very deafening inflationary aspect to it. And the people that get hurt the most, people on fixed incomes. Elderly on fixed incomes are gonna get really hurt badly because the price of goods and services are gonna go up, and I don't think their Social Security is gonna go up. That's the problem with it. It hurts people more than it helps people. I had one lady tell me, oh, that's not going to happen. I said, if you go to Dunkin' Donuts, your coffee's going to go up, your donut's going to go up. And so if a group of elderly meet once a week for lunch or for breakfast, they're going to find their meals going up. And her response was, no, that's not going to happen. All they got to do is sell a little more coffee. But it doesn't work that way. That's not how it works. Now, the last one I want to talk about is similar to the unemployment, but it's the 3% surcharge on successful people. And I say successful people, others like to call them the wealthy. But here, if you make $200,000 a year, any family who makes $200,000 a year is going to pay a 3% penalty. Your income tax is going to go to 10%. And that's because the schools say they need more money. Well, let me tell you about the schools. The Maine Education Association is promoting this bill. I am sitting in a school. The problem with schools is not money. In the last 20 years, we've lost 25,000 students in K through 12. The schools have added pre-K to the enrollment numbers to keep the numbers up to about 177,000 kids. So state of Maine has 177,000 kids in our public schools. We have 127 superintendents. The average high school in America has 1,500 students. Do the math. Now, let me go one step further. State of Florida has 3 million kids, K through 12. Okay, just under 3 million kids. They have 64 superintendents. They are ranked number 7 for quality of education, and we're somewhere in the 30s, and I see the most common number I see is around 38. So, we have declining enrollment. In the last decade, our school costs have gone up 18%. We have declining enrollment, increasing costs, and flat performance. I think we ought to take the top-heavy system, reduce the amount of school districts, put more money into the classroom. The problem with Maine is we underpay our teachers. That's the big problem. The money's not going where it belongs, in the classroom. I have said to the MEA, tell you what we'll do. I'll put up $5 million, you put up $5 million. And we'll have and you can even manage the money. But the money's gonna be dedicated to teachers who wanna get advanced degrees and further education. We will pay for it. They put the time in, our partnership will pay for their schooling. I did it in 2011, 2012, 2013, 2014, and 2015. I still haven't sent a letter yet because I'm still waiting for the response on the first letter. So there's no interest in helping teachers. If you don't help the teachers, you're certainly not helping your kids. So what we need to do as a state is we need to demand more efficient, more effective school. And I mean that by the spending of the monies. We have some people in the state of Maine who have spent a career teaching, and they've retired. Some are making as high as $250,000 retired. Believe it or not. What they do is they retire, collect a pension of about $125,000 if you're a superintendent. Then they get another teaching contract, and they go back to work on Monday. Retire on Friday, go back to work on Monday, full salary. Just not right, and the Maine people aren't getting their money's worth. So paying that 3% surcharge is gonna do one of two things. It's gonna continue the same burden we're on and more money going into schools, but there's nothing with that new money that's gonna improve the education. Nobody's saying improve the education. And there's the one thing I always hear, well, the Maine people passed a referendum that says state will pay 55% of education. Guess what? It's impossible to meet it. As your governor, The state has no say in the budget. Budgets is developed by the superintendents and the school districts. So every year, the closer you get to 55%, the more the school increases, the costs increase. It is crazy, this system. It doesn't work. The way it's developed, it doesn't work. The EPS formula doesn't work. So what we need to do is, instead of saying we're going to develop our education based on the valuation of the town, what we should be saying is we're going to base our education on the students. We put how much money we want to pay our students for their education. We have students in Maine that pay upwards of $30,000 a year. The islands, some of the remote islands, we have some families on it. The education for the students is like $30,000 a year between the state and local. State pays a much higher percentage in poor communities than in wealthy communities. If we had a state teacher's contract, instead of spending the hundreds of thousands of dollars in legal bills from all the school districts, they hire lawyers to negotiate. If we had a state teacher's contract, we'd set the floor, the maximum, and the mid-range, and then you allow for performance of the teacher. And then the good teachers could get paid as well in a rural community as they do in Cape Elizabeth, Yarmouth, Falmouth. Right now, and I don't blame a teacher, if you make more money in Cape Elizabeth, you'll go to Cape Elizabeth. The rural communities and the poor communities suffer dearly with the system we have in place. So I don't think charging people an extra 3% will do a couple of things. One, puts more money into the school system, doesn't guarantee any improvement in education, but more importantly, it's going to intensify and speed up the rate at which people leave the state of Maine, because another reason to leave. Right now we have a maximum tax of 7.15%. If you add 3% onto that, it's 10.15%, and you could take a job in another state for less money with less cost of living, and you're better off. For instance, New Hampshire. You can go to New Hampshire, you can go to South Dakota, you could go to the Carolinas, you can go to Florida. Many states, and this is where I gotta tell you some facts here that really drives this home. The average income tax for New England states is 6.6%, the average. Maine's at 7.15, and New Hampshire doesn't have one. The average income tax for rural states, small states like Maine, Wyoming, Montana, some of the Rhode Island, some of the states with smaller populations, 5.16%. We're 7.15. The average income tax, state income tax in the United States of America, in all 50 states, the average is 5.5%. Or round up to 5.6 if you'd like. It's still well below the 7.15. Now, Maine is a beautiful state. It's a great place to live, but it's an expensive place to live. And if you live north of Augusta, you have very little to say on what goes on in Augusta, because all the votes come out of two counties, Cumberland and York. And the only time that you will hear the Democrats agree with me is election year. Because this year, they voted in all my welfare reform proposals that I've been working on 5 years, because we've been doing these town halls and they're gaining attention. And people, the polls were up in the 80 percentile. And right now the polls are running in the 80 percentile of wanting a lower income tax. So it's up to you. My message tonight is it's who you send to Augusta makes a big difference. It is up to you to demand from the elected officials what you want to live under. No, but you have a say in the poll. The poll, when you go into that poll and you close that curtain, forget all the polls around the state, just that ballot, that voting booth does make a real difference. Now, if you recall, less than 2 years ago now, a little over a year and a half, they were saying the night before the election, every single media source in America, every single one, NBC, ABC, CBS, MSNBC, CNN, all of it, including Fox News, said, I had no path to victory. I had no way of winning. And then you folks went into that little voting booth, and voila, I got more votes than anyone in the history of the state. So the votes do count. They really do count. So with that, I'm going to open it up for Adrian, and we can answer some questions.
Well, I'm going to trade you, Mr. Governor. So Channel 5 wants their mic up. Mal wants to get his mic up. I'm going to take this.
Okay.
And we're going to turn this one, that one on. Yep.
Okay.
Oh, it's on.
Is it on or not?
Nope, it's off.
There we go.
Try that.
Still hear me? Good.
Very good.
First question. Okay.
I've been a state employee for 39 years, and I want to know when you're going to give us more than 1% since 2008.
That's more than you got before that. Well, let me tell you what I've done. That's not quite true. I've offered 3%, and you refused it.
Because we had to break the easement to do it.
Well, no. I don't know. Okay. I offered, this is what I offered. First of all, when I became governor, I got rid of furlough days, which everybody got a 20% increase because one day a week is 20% of your wages. The other thing I did is I offered 3% if you gave up fair share. In other words, those people that don't want to be paying dues are forced to keep their job in Maine. If you want to keep that, the only one that benefits is the union. You lose 2% and you got 1%. The option was you keep it and you get 1%. I think that's a great deal. That's a great deal. I've cut your retirement deficiency from $4.4 billion down to $2.2 billion. So I think that's all for the employees. I can only... First of all, I am working for the executive branch of government. It's all I can do. I do not appropriate money. I cannot. The legislature appropriates the money. If they don't give me the money, I can't spend it. For instance, right now, I'm told we're going to have a needle exchange program for heroin addicts. It's about $75,000 a year for needles. But they didn't give me the money. So the program's not going to go forward. It does take money. And I don't think, see, I became governor in 2011. In 2011, 2012, there was no increases. We froze it. And all the way back from 2008, the previous governor did what the previous governor did. I gave, the last 2 years, I gave offers of 3%. Some unions took it, some unions didn't. I can't make your decisions, or can't make the union decisions, but all I know is this. You lost 2%, but the union dues went to the unions. End of story.
Social Security and military pensions are exempt from state income tax. Given that your income tax proposal is going to cut hundreds of millions of dollars from state revenues, won't that result in increases in sales tax and property tax that are going to fall on these same people that currently don't pay income tax?
It shouldn't, the net effect of it is, the sales tax would go up. And the reason the sales tax goes up is this. There's 803,000 people in the state of Maine who work. Out of the 1.3 million people, 803,000 work. Those are the people that pay the entire income tax, the full boat. In the summer months between May 31st and Labor Day, Maine has over right around 40 million visitors that come to Maine for vacationing. Yes, my intention is to increase the sales tax and have them pay the majority of the increase, have them pay a higher share. Now, my proposal also had anybody on fixed income to get a credit on the sales tax. So they wouldn't pay any more now. In fact, they'd pay less. For most cases, they'd pay less than they pay now. Now, on the home ownership, when I was the mayor of Waterville, every single year, I reduced taxes. I took it at 29 mils, I dropped it down to 21 mils when I left 8 years later. Average home was getting, I think over that period of time, it was $600 back. I wasn't gone 3 years, it was right back up. For things like unbelievable things, not things that were truly needed, but what I consider luxury things. If you have a high tax, income tax, you can have a high sales tax, and you have a high property tax, which Maine, frankly, when it's compared around the country, isn't as high as you think. I have a $200,000 home in Florida. My taxes are $1,800. I have a $200,000 home in Maine. My taxes are $4,000. So we are much higher than Florida, but you look at New Hampshire, and we're just slightly below New Hampshire. Not greatly below New Hampshire, slightly below New Hampshire. New Hampshire has no sales tax, no income tax. The additional increase in sales tax would be picked up by 40 million people instead of just 803,000 paying in it. The other thing that we have done that's generated $50 million a year that we didn't have before I became governor is the liquor business. The liquor business was sold by my predecessor 10 years ago for $100 million for 10 years. That's roughly $10 million a year, and we made about a bonus of about $17 million over that. So I think it was $17 million, maybe it was $27 million. But it was like $127 million, let's say. This year, I mean, since we've taken it in-house, we're running $50 million to the state coffers. $50 million a year. We've lowered the cost of liquor, and we've increased the profit margin to retailers, and we're still making $50 million a year. So my point is, there's many different ways that you can improve. When I became governor, we had a $250 million shortfall in Medicaid every year. Now, we haven't had a shortfall in Medicaid for 2 years. We're paying our bills. We've paid $750 million to our hospitals without raising any taxes. So we can do it. Interestingly enough, when we were at 8.5% income tax, our revenues were less than they are at 7.15. It's like a store. Put it on sale, you sell more. You make yourself more attractive, more people will come. And that's what we're trying to accomplish, is to get a more robust economy by not paying higher minimum wage, but higher living wage. Higher, for instance, I'll give you one right now. We had the opportunity in the state of Maine to have some mining done up in Aroostook County. The jobs were going to be about 250 jobs. They pay between $60,000 and $90,000 a year. And the Natural Resource Council of Maine fought us and fought us and fought us, and the people in Aroostook County are just as poor today as they were 4 years ago, because we have organizations that don't want business in Maine. All they want is the out-of-staters to come in, be here for the summer, and then they leave, and their money's left behind to protect the environment. Many of them. Many, many, many of them. In fact, I've got a list now, and I'm looking down through the contributors to the Natural Resource Council of Maine, and the overwhelming majority of the money comes from out of state. I mean, millions of dollars are coming from national foundations. Paper mills. We have the ability to fix some of the problems of the paper mills. The issues of the paper mill is overtaxation. Give you an example. Bucksport Mill closed last year. Bucksport Mill was sold for $59 million to be taken down, to be raised. They could have sold it for $62 million and kept it operating, but the owners didn't want that paper in the market. The town of Bucksport was charging him taxes on a value of $700 million. The mill in Millinocket closed in 2009, I believe. I think it was 2008. They closed for the final time. In 2011, they came to me and said, "We have a sudden and severe issue." I said, "What do you mean?" "Well, the mill's closed and we're not collecting taxes." I said, "Well, the mill's been closed for 3 years." So they sued us and all this, and we went to court. We won because they hadn't taken any action. You know how much they were charging that mill on the at the time? The mill was closed for 3 years. In 2011, they were assessing the mill at $185 million. That's why they weren't getting their taxes, because it sold for $2.9 million. That's what it sold for. Same thing is happening in Jay, same thing is happening in Sappy, same thing's happening in Madison Paper. Now all the paper companies are going back to their towns and say we need to have tax abatements. And there's some work being done in that area. But those are the type of things that we do that hurt business. We can have business. Airbus said, "Are you a right to work state?" "No." What's your energy cost?" I said, "Well, the cheapest in New England." "Well, how do you compare with Alabama?" Because that's where they wanted to go. "We're about just roughly 10 cents higher per kilowatt hour than Alabama." That's 2/3 higher. And people don't realize that it's millions upon millions upon millions of dollars for these mills to pay electricity costs. We have a mill right now in Rumford, Mexico, Maine. 14 employees, they make furniture, very high-end furniture. He tells me, "My electricity bill is $9,000 a month. At $9,000 a month, I lose money. At $7,000 a month, I would break even. At $6,000 a month, I would make a little bit of money. But I'm paying $30,000 a year, have been doing so for the last 4 or 5 years just to keep the 14 people working." That's the type of thing that we have to be innovative about so we can lower the cost of doing business in Maine. Energy and taxation are two big ones. So the revenues in Maine are higher now than they were in 2011. We've lowered our taxes. It's an interesting thing. Now we had two casinos. They've been relatively successful. Now we're going to try to put a third one. Big mistake. Because when you put the second one in, the casinos sort of shrunk. Now with a third one, they're going to shrink again. Because there's only so much money in Maine. And the problem is we were drawn from New Hampshire and Massachusetts, but Massachusetts putting in a $1 billion casino at Suffolk Downs. So those guys are likely not to come up to 95.
Tom Stevens.
Good evening, Governor.
Good evening.
Thanks for coming to Oakland. Pleasure to see you. Well, my question is on income tax for a corporation. I think it should be 0% based on if right now companies are leaving for taxation. Zero, won't they flock here?
The answer to your question is yes. And not only are they leaving Maine and going to other states, but many companies are leaving the United States unless you're from France, few others. But most companies are leaving the United States and going to Ireland, Canada, and other countries because their tax structures are much less. Up until a few years ago, Maine was one of the higher income taxes in the world. We had Canada ahead of us, we had Japan ahead of us, we had France ahead of us, and now we are the highest. Canada's taking their corporate tax down to 25%, Japan's taking theirs down to 25%, we're still at 39.5. We have $2 billion sitting offshore because the American companies won't bring it back because they're gonna get double taxed. And that's the problem. We are just taxing ourselves into oblivion. We cannot prosper by taxing ourselves. We only can prosper by economic growth, and taxation is not part of that formula. So you're absolutely correct. I can't even get the income tax down, which people that are voting on it won't reduce it. Think about it, corporations, they're invisible. They don't get a say. And you're absolutely right.
Next question, Craig Sturtevant.
Hey, my name is Craig Sturtevant. Thank you for coming to Oakland. I was just wondering, Mr. King's going to be up for re-election if you're thinking possibly of making a run at him.
Yes, I am. That's if I'm not in Washington.
Mr. Governor, I'm not really great at speaking or anything. I'm an ex-mill worker who got sick, had a great pain, John, and now between my wife and I got medical. Am I better off on Maine Care or Medicare? I end up in a donut hole 3 months into the year.
Okay.
Am I better off on Maine Care?
Well,
I'm not discriminated to get my medicine.
No. This is how it works. If you're 65 years old and older, you qualify for Medicare. If you're on Medicare and you don't have enough to pay for the supplemental, or you don't have enough money to pay for your medicines, you can get on Maine Care. You can be what is called a dual eligible. And so if you're on Medicare and you have on a fixed income, you could qualify for dual eligible. But let me tell you about that. Last year, I tried, there was 4,200 people that were qualified for Maine Care that are either elderly, on fixed incomes, disabled, or had mental issues. They're on a wait list. I fully paid for the wait list, got it completely done. It was $46 million. The legislature took $30 million out of the 46 and reduced the wait list from 4,200 down to 3,000. And the $30 million they took out went to schools and undocumented aliens in Portland and Lewiston. And I think that's sad, because people who lived here their whole lives, here in Maine, had money taken away from them. They earned it. They paid their taxes, and they've earned it. And I will tell you another thing about welfare that really irritates me, is a person, I just happen to know of a specific case, a man just passed away a couple of months ago, but the last 4 years been struggling with cancer. The first year, he was out of work, so he got family leave, and then he got the COLA for a year. So the second year, and after the second year, lost his insurance. Because he still had a house and a car, the state couldn't help him. He had to sell the house and the car, spend all that money before he qualified for welfare. Now, he hit a bump in the road, and welfare should be to help those that hit a bump in the road, not a lifetime lifestyle. And that's why I've been fighting welfare, is to fix it. So the people that live in Maine, brought up in Maine, run into a bump in the road or are disabled, mentally ill, or elderly should get the services, and we should have a safety net that protects them. But in the zeal to protect everybody, we can't protect anybody. And that's what happened. I had a gentleman right here in Waterville one morning, about 4 years ago. He's leaning on his car, and he's got a leg missing from above the knee. It's gone. He's just one leg, and he's leaning there. He was a veteran, and through no fault of his own, he fell through the crack, and VA, and whatever happened, he couldn't get anybody to help him. And we had just hired a new lawyer in the office. She'd been there about a week. So I came back from work, I took his name and number, and I said, I'll have somebody call you to see if we can help you. So I called Holly, her name was Holly Lusk. I said, Holly, come in here. I got a job for you, I need a leg. I need you to find me a leg and give it to this guy. And didn't she do it in 2 weeks? She had found a leg, man's back to working, he's happy as a lark. That's what we really want to do. Those are the things we really work to do every day. The problem is, we have to deal with legislators, there's 186 of them, and they all have their own agendas. And that's the problem. There are three types of legislators. Three types. One, the very ambitious ones. And they'd sell their mother for a nickel. That's all about them. That's all they care about is ambition, ambition, I want to be the next governor. And right now, there's a whole lot of them want to be the next governor. Then you have personal enrichment people. About a third of the people down there is for personal enrichment. It's all about them, but they don't want to just have power. They want to have money. They're there to make money. They make deals. Those are real dangerous people. But you know where they're coming from, so you can deal with them. Then you have the third one. And there's a lady right here, Kelly Goulet, who's going to run for the legislature. I guarantee you, having known her for years, she's going for the right reason, for work for you, the Maine people. Many of us do that because the legislature thinks, and the newspapers think I have ulterior motives. Yes.
Thank you, Governor.
Oh,
thank you.
Kelly Kutcher,
I'm a select candidate for District 77, which is Oakland, Sydney. I'm a strong supporter of your plan to bring Maine from poverty to prosperity. The people that I've talked to recently tell me that they need to have lower energy costs. They need to. And They noticed in the paper that the solar bill was vetoed, and the legislature did not override the veto this time. And we're wondering why you believe solar is not the answer for Maine, and if not, what can we do to help Mainers get their energy costs lower?
Maine right now is paying 14 cents a kilowatt hour. Now, let's give you a comparison. 14 cents a kilowatt hour for an average home is roughly $80 to $90 a month. If you live in Montreal and you have the same home, you pay about $30, $32. Why? They have hydro. Hydro is 24 hours continuous. Solar is 12 hours, then it gets dark. That's a problem. The problem with solar and the problem with wind is you can't store it. You have to use it when it's made. And above market, if the solar bill would have been at market rates, if it would have been sold at market rates, I'd have been right there taking it. I would have said, fine, we're not going to pay more. But to have it, you have to pay more. You have to subsidize the developers. Each turbine for wind is about $300,000. I don't know what the exact number is for a solar panel, but it's equivalent. So the problem is, until solar becomes less expensive and you can store it, then it's really not a baseline, it's intermittent power. So at night, you gotta have another source. That's the problem with solar and wind. is you can't just do with hydro, the Boulder Dam runs all the time. Now the Hoover Dam, but it runs 24 hours a day. So it's making electricity 24 hours a day. Natural gas, you make electricity 24 hours a day. Nuclear is 24 hours a day. Sun, only when it's shining. And wind, only when the wind's blowing. So that's the problem. And if it was less, you could take it. The problem, let me tell you what happens when the sun's shining. Like today, sun's shining. We have a gas plant in Rumford. It generates electricity at 3 cents a kilowatt hour. When the sun shines, they shut down because you can turn the switch off. But you can't do that with sun. It's a real dynamic that people don't really understand.
Jan Partridge?
This has anything to do with anything except for Priscilla, who is now 13, hated that she couldn't be here tonight because she loves to listen to you talk. And at the caucus, she was just absolutely, you talk so well.
Okay. Bruce doesn't think so.
That's all. Ray Watson?
Good to see you in Oakland, Governor. Thank you for coming. My question is really related to the solar question. You probably have already answered it, but I'll ask the question. In today's Morning Sentinel, there was a letter to the editor regarding the Statoil wind program that you had, according to the article, undone. I'm just curious to know why you elected to do that and how you did that.
Okay. That's a fair question. The solar, the Statoil issue came in and they wanted a pilot program and you're going to pay 31 cents for it. We were going to pay 30 cents kilowatt because it was a pilot program with no guarantees other than if it really worked, they may build windmills in Maine. That was the deal. It was going to cost the Maine people over $200 million. We were going to add $200 million to your electricity bill, and you were going to pay for it. That's why I stopped it. And why was I able to stop it? Is they hadn't put the ink to the pen. I mean, the ink to the paper. At the time that I became governor, we were able to stop it that way. What I did is I just put up a bill to the legislature that said, the University of Maine is doing a lot of research in wind, in offshore wind. Why weren't they allowed to bid in? So we allowed them to bid in. They bid in, they came in less than Statoil. So that project is still going on and we may still have a Statoil project, I mean a deep water project in the next year or so. Incidentally, Statoil got into a whole lot of trouble after they left Maine and they let that go because they got problems in Europe.
Thank you for coming. What my question is that I'd like to see some kind of law that when places close up, that they got to give their employees at least a 2 week, a month's notice. Now, going back 3 years, there was a place that closed up that sold financing stuff. They took money for orders. And all of that, and then they just closed up, and the people lost their money. There was a gym that they took membership fees right up until the day that they closed. The people lost that money, and there wouldn't be any deposit on having something like that. That they should get at least a 30-day notice so that the employees can go out and find other work and say if they need a car, they find out they are going to lose their job,
In the state of Maine, we have what is called a severance law. So when a company is going to go out of business, they are required to pay severance based on the years of service a person has worked there. They get a week's pay for every year they've been there. Verso, which was in Bucksport, they paid the severance, but it got a little bit tricky because they sort of closed very quickly. You're right, they're supposed to give a notice, but...
You don't enforce the rules, then?
Well, no, that's not the reason. Let me try to explain it. They paid their severance because when they said they were leaving, we jumped all over it immediately, and we made sure that they paid that severance, and it was somewhat contentious for a couple of weeks, but we got them to pay because they had other plants in Maine, so it was okay. Madison Paper, when they decided to leave, they paid that at the most. I mean, those people are great people. They paid really good severance to everybody. Their health care, their severance, they're a class act because they're a world-class company. They're not going broke. They're just leaving Maine and going to Minnesota because a lot of it has to do with everything I talked about earlier. The problem with what you say is sometimes the companies run out of cash. Look, you can intend to, I did 18 years of workouts and turnarounds, and you go in with all the best intentions of keeping the business going. Some things happen, make a couple of bad decisions, next thing you know, you're running low on cash. Once you run out of cash, it's the end. It's the end. It's over. You're done. Cash is king in business. Without cash, you're closed. You can give a notice, but if you run out of cash, notice doesn't make any difference.
Yeah, but the thing is, whoever is doing their bookkeeping needs to count them.
You're absolutely correct, and it's great, and that the businesses, and we had some in this area that went broke. Businesses, no matter how honest they want to be and how trustworthy they want to be and they want to do the right thing, sometimes they make mistakes, and when the mistake is made, just because you made a mistake and you run out of cash doesn't mean you're a bad person. It means you're probably just a bad manager, or it could be that things that you had planned didn't turn out. I'll give you an example at the company in Lewiston that they used to make light bulbs. You can't sell light bulbs anymore. You had to reinvent themselves. So they've reinvented themselves into new industries, and they're trying to build that business. It's relatively new because they've changed into new industries, and it's nick and tuck. They're trying to reinvent themselves. They're not bad people, but they're working just like some people live on paychecks week to week, paycheck to paycheck. Some businesses are that way. Should they close? Is it better that they close or that they try to stay open and survive? Personally, I say you stay open and you try to make it. I'll give you an example of that. East Millinocket Mill was going to go broke. They filed for bankruptcy. They closed. A company came in. They wanted to give it a shot. I was criticized for giving them about a $20 million tax break, tax credit. And in retrospect, we probably should have done more work, but we knew going in it was a very high-risk venture. We knew it. They lasted 2 years. In the 2 years, they bought $274 million of wood and labor from that region. So was it $20 million worth it? Well, you lost the $20 million, but you got $274 million into that economy for 24 months. So I would say it was worth it. And it was nick and tuck all the way. So the laws are in place, and some will tell you ahead of time, and some they don't. And some people go to jail for not doing the right thing.
What I'm saying is that companies, they don't wake up in the morning and say, well, I guess we are going to close the door.
in the severance bill is there to do that. When they're going to close the door, if you have over 50 people, you are required to tell the employees and the state. What I'm saying is, if they don't, what do? You try to get your money back or you try to put them in jail?
You can speak to your legislators, too.
You see what I'm saying? Is a lot of it's based on your honesty, too. And no, look, I ran a company once that it was an investment of $54 million, about $30 million, never made it to the building of the plant. It was in Houston and Florida and the Caribbean and condo in France. And there are some people like that out there.
We've got one more written question. Jackie Barr?
I got to admit, confess my honor. You take a little point in your trouble.
Hi, babe. How are you?
Good.
I want to thank you for taking care of my sister when she died. What I'm concerned about, because a lot of stuff, politics, I don't understand. But what I'm concerned about is light. I'm concerned about babies being born and being aborted. And it's a lot of money for abortion and Planned Parenthood. If that would be eliminated, couldn't that money go to something else that's more worthwhile?
Well, the answer to that is yes. And Planned Parenthood is not aborting babies in Maine that I'm aware of. They are nationally, I understand, but they're not doing it in Maine. And we also audited their books, and they're not selling fetal parts in Maine. So I agree. I don't disagree with you. But let me say this about life, because I think life is very, very important. One of the most important assets on the face of this globe is life, is human life. And the problem that I've been having as your governor is we have organizations, I mentioned one earlier, is the Natural Resource Council of Maine. Natural Resource Council of Maine does everything and anything. Their whole mission in life is for the environment. It's everything to protect the environment. We have to be good stewards of our planet. We have to be a good steward of our air, our mountains, our forests, our rivers, our lakes, our oceans. We have to be, because nobody else will do it for us. It cannot be one state versus another. It cannot be one country versus another. It has to be everybody on this planet doing their part. However, if we only concern ourselves with the environment and nothing else, we create enormous poverty. And Maine is a good example of having created poverty in many of our counties. I'd say Aroostook County is a lot of poverty, Washington County, Piscataquis, parts of Somerset. Those are very, very poor. On the other hand, if you don't take care of your environment, you have an environmental catastrophe. So I look at Maine, and I say Maine has the largest number of forests that is certified green in the United States. It has the cleanest air, the most renewable portfolio of its energy in the United States. We do. We're like 2/3 of our power is renewable. We have the only sustainable fisheries with our lobster fisheries in the world. So we are good stewards of our land and our oceans. The problem is we haven't been able to work with the environmental groups to find balance. We have to find balance between good jobs and good living for the people, for human activity on the face of the earth so they can feed their families. And we have to find a balance on using the best technologies and the best practices known to man for any activity we do. But the answer in both cases is not just saying no. It was very upsetting to see the Natural Resource Council of Maine fight us and defeat us on providing mining jobs in northern Maine. I just couldn't understand what their rationale was. We were going to use the best practices known to man, the best technologies. we were going to be providing $60,000 to $90,000 job a year, and the answer was no. And the overwhelming majority of the money that comes in from out of state. That's sad. So sometimes we think we're doing good, but we're literally killing people, because people in poverty do die. They die from lack of nutrition, lack of proper medicines, lack of many different things. So it's more than just abortion. I maintain there's a lot to it, and a lot more to it than we recognize. For instance, I think it was absolutely critically wrong for the legislature in the state of Maine to put people on a wait list when the money was right there to take them off. And to put the money in areas that, while I don't mind helping my neighbor, but I want to feed my family first. And my family is Maine people.
We don't have any more written questions.
Okay, there's a question there.
Thank you very much, Governor. My name is Andrew Cook, and I'm from Rome, and I really appreciate your discussion. The electric power situation in Maine and New England is quite complex. As you pointed out, the possibility of bringing in low-cost hydro from Quebec. Also, the challenge of bringing natural gas up into Maine, which could be used to generate electricity, which would be exported out of state. So I'm wondering if you could comment on the complexity of natural gas pipeline, electric power transmission from the north, and how to integrate that in the whole New England electric power system. And I realize it's quite a complicated situation.
It's complicated, but it's really not. You know, it sounds complicated, electricity. You talk about natural gas, you talk about hydro, you talk about wind, solar, nuclear, oil, coal. This present administration has virtually killed and will close up most of the coal-fired power plants in the United States. However, there's a technology in Maine that can take 90% of the emissions of the carbon and everything out of the effluents from the coal mills. But nobody wants to advertise that. And guess where the company is? Right here in Maine. Right here in Maine is a company that has a technology to build bag houses that will eliminate a lot of the CO2s that go into the atmosphere. We don't talk about that. Winterizing your home is part of your electric grid. They're saying, if you winterize, you use less energy. Let me tell you one thing. About heating, that is correct. About the electricity grid, it's totally false. And the reason it's false is every time we turn around, there's a new electronic gadget that needs to be charged. I have a briefcase that has got 3 or 4 wires in it that plug to all kinds of different gadgets, and they all need electricity. Electricity is not going to be reduced. It's going to be more. There are many different ways to generate it, as we said. We buy our power from the New England grid. We are a net exporter of power. Much of the wind power we make doesn't stay here in Maine. It's sold to New Hampshire, Massachusetts, Connecticut, and they get carbon credits for it. So now the new thing is not only the cost of the energy, but you get credits, so you lower your overall cost. We have 2 pipelines being built. They're not big enough to solve our capacity issues, but one will be in progress in 17, go into production 17, one likely in 18. They're smaller. We need a big one. It's being held up. It was being held up in the state of New York, and now I understand that it may not ever happen. I'm going to be meeting with Kinder Morgan here in the next couple weeks when I get back after next week, and we're going to be discussing it to see if we can revive it. But that's really the ultimate solution to reestablishing a manufacturing base and utilizing our forest in Maine is to have a capacity for low-cost energy. We can buy, and Vermont has done it. Vermont has a 40-year contract with the province of Quebec for hydro. They got it for about 6 cents. Right now, we, being only 20 miles up in the Cobourg-Gore area, we're only about 20 miles on our side and 20 miles on their side to interconnect, we could be transmitting electricity down to southern New England and be paid wheeling costs for it. We could let it go through Maine and get paid for it. And then buy 6 cent power, we could get it for 5 cents. The problem right now is New Hampshire has the dibs on it. And New Hampshire has been playing around for a couple of years, and they're reaching the point where they're going to have to make a decision this year, because it's an election year, obviously. The governor of New Hampshire is going to run for the Senate, so that's going to be left, a decision is going to have to be made. As soon as that decision is made, Maine and Vermont are ready to pounce. Maine's willing to put 40 miles and go down through the CMP process, system, and Vermont wants to go under Lake Champlain into upstate New York. So we have opportunities. There's a lot of stuff being talked about. But in the meantime, there's a lot of people, you know, with the opportunity to come in and try to sell us on the solar. But if we get sold on the solar, was really a bad deal for Maine. Back in the 80s, in the 1980s, we had what we called the PPA contracts, private power producers contracts. Those contracts were front-end loaded. In other words, they were paying them like 14 cents. At the time, electricity was like 7 cents. So they went, all the difference between the contract price, what you had to contract, and what the market was, the difference went into a place called stranded cost. We have been paying millions upon millions upon millions of dollars every year on stranded costs. It's going to end at the end of 2017, early 2018. We will have paid our debt. The solar and the wind were going to add to that. That's the reason why it was above market. Whenever you hear above market, run. It's not good. Somebody is trying to sell you a bridge to nowheres. You can't get there from here. That's what above market means. It means that whatever you're paying today, they're going to increase the rate. I don't believe that's good for Maine, because we've made, this state was very prosperous in the 50s because we had a very strong manufacturing base. We've lost it, but we haven't lost our forest. So it's a matter of finding low energy and then finding people. Investment capital will go where it's welcomed and stays where it's appreciated. And so what we got to do is we got to welcome people with money to Maine and appreciate them while they're here. Overtaxing them is not what I call appreciation. And gouging them is not a good way to do it. Now, the left, or the Maine's People Alliance, will believe that more taxation, you take it from the rich and you give to the poor. That's the Robin Hood way. We've gone beyond that now, because the rich people get smart. They found places like Florida and Texas to go to. So now we got to do more than being Robin Hood. We got to appreciate them a little bit more. And so that's really, you know, there are people that will come in and make great investments. But if you notice, the last few years, those that are real will look at all the states and take the places where it's cheapest to do business, and those that are struggling, they want to sell you a bridge to nowhere. And it's always going to cost you. And so that's why we have companies that are legitimate. We're working with a couple of companies out of China that have some interest in Maine. We have a company that's building what is called a medical tourism in Auburn. These are going to be wealthy Chinese people who come and use our medical system, and they pay for it, because our system is better than the system they have in China. Food safety is another area that China is looking to America for, to find, to get involved in buying foods and technologies in food. IDEX here, a main company, is huge in China because of what they do with animals, animal husbandry, and they keep them healthy. So we have some opportunities. We just got to be a little bit more open-minded and willing to go after those that, look, it's going to cost. You got to make an investment, but you got to make an investment, like I got a letter on the way here. I was reading it. And the letter said, the reason that Franklin Hospital in Farmington laid off people was because Medicare and Medicaid don't pay the full cost of hospital care. Agreed. And Maine didn't expand Medicaid. Well, if they don't pay the full cost, isn't, if you buy something under cost and you sell it lower than you paid, isn't going to help you. So if expanding isn't going to cover the costs, why do you expand? So what you got to do is change the method, the system. And we're trying very hard. Many states, about 30 of us, are working, trying to convince the federal government that payment for like a service is not the way to go. We should be paying to keep people healthy. That's a better deal. So you give them a population, you say you keep them healthy. Rather than say you get $30,000 for one knee, and you go to Boston and get two knees for $19,000.
And by the time you actually, even if you can even get there, everything's gone up, cost you more, and your health's declined, you just, it never balances. So it's kind of almost like, reaching into the, you never can get there, you know what I mean?
Yeah, healthcare in this country is in trouble.
So they wait, so the cost go up, prices go up, they wait longer.
Well, one of the issues in this country has been that we have addressed the access side of the equation. We have not addressed the cost side of the equation. And until we do that, we're still going to have the imbalance, so we have to do that. Well, it's that time.
It is. We've run over on our time, but we do want to thank you for coming out tonight. And we encourage you to grab one of these sheets on your way out. It's the sheet that explains who your legislators in this area are. Contact them with your issues, your concerns, your ideas, and get involved as much as you can.
And I'd like to say to Posey, thank you for having us. I see Bob Nutting here. Bob Nutting has turned out this, but don't let him be out too long. Just keep that in mind. He's only got to stay out for a little short time. I tried to get him to run for another office, but we got to keep him back in Augusta because he is really, he's one of the great legislators that I have seen over the last 5 years. And I don't tell him that because he is just truly a good legislator. And I'm sure Kelly will do the same. Is anybody else here?
Good.
Good luck to everybody.
And thank you all. And I will tell you, this November is an important vote. It's an important, a very, very important election. We have moved, being a governor and trying to reform, being a reform governor, it's like moving this huge battleship. And we've moved it a little bit, and we need to continue to move it, and you need to elect people that want to help Maine people. It's not about them, it's about you. You're the boss. You're the one that needs the services, and you need to demand it from our legislators. The one thing that I have seen when I say about ambition, so many people run for the legislature and they'll tell you anything you want to hear. And then they go to Augusta and you never hear another thing. Those are the people we want to get rid of. And we have term limits. And I will tell you, in the state of Maine, I don't disagree with term limits. I think they're good. I just think the ones we put in place are too short. Because it's 8 years and it takes you a while to get the hang of things. And then you're running for election again and then you're out. But when you're governor, you're looking for that day. Thank you all.